The Philips SensorTouch 3D Shaver. Wow.
Sexy.
With its click-on beard styler, it has an answer for every face.
Marti Pellow and Graeme Clark from Wet 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 are joining us in the studio, and these boys know a thing or two about greatest hits and number one. So have a look at this.
You hear me so clearly and see.
Well, there's, although there's three wets, there's normally four of them, but there's only two of them in the studio today.
Me Marti and Jackie could do the extra singing, couldn't we?
They've made up the numbers.
Yeah.
Aye.
Where are the other two? Do they not do early mornings?
They don't do the early shift.
No,
they don't do the early shift. And obviously, we knew we were coming to talk to your good self, so we said, no, it's OK. We'll be taking care of that one.
You will be, you will be. And the new album, Step by Step.
Aye.
And this is a greatest hits, Graeme.
It is indeed. It's got 17 old tracks and it's got three new tracks. So, as well as looking back, we're looking forward to it.
Yeah. How many number ones have you had, or how many number one albums?
I've lost count, actually. It's
done all
too
right.
Many. We had
exceptionally well, aye.
We'd one in the 80s, we had two in the 90s, and all our albums went to number one, so fingers crossed for this going to number one.
Now, tell me this. You two go back how long knowing each other?
42 years.
So, school?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, when we were wee tiny, tiny boys. Wee tiny hands.
Yeah.
We decided to start the band when we were actually in the football team together. And because we were terrible at football. Well, Graeme was better than me. I was lousy.
You're too kind. He's too kind.
I was lousy. Yeah, and that's when we decided to start the band,
but
and that's when we met Tommy and
Neil. It's
a great
story. Like, how many guys at school and girls would have said, we want to form a band, and there you guys actually did it and lived the dream?
Absolutely. And woe betide anybody who told us any different. I think that was the power of the collective, because we all had that vision, if you like. And when we left school, we managed to, you know, we didn't get a job, you know, in the shipyards like the rest of our families, because they were kind of shut. And our music became our escapism, and then it became a chance for us to, instead of getting around the world in a ship, building a ship, we built these songs, and that's what took us round.
And what was your name then? Because it wasn't Marti Pellow, was
Mark
it?
Mark McLachlan.
Yeah.
McLachlan is my father's name. I'm very proud of that. Lovely tartan it is too.
Where did Pellow come from?
That's my mother's maiden name.
Oh, is it? Lovely.
I think it's so amazing when you talk to them. You're so Glasgow, aren't you? You support Rangers, you're so Scottish, and then when you sing, you have this amazing velvet voice that could be from anywhere in the world,
I think,
but probably not from Scotland.
Well, you know, I think like, if we sang the way we speak, we'd be in the Proclaimers, wouldn't we? Really, let's face it. And I would be very happy to be in that band. Yeah, great. Very good they are too. And I think it's got a lot to do, especially from a vocalist point of view, of what records you listen to and when you're growing up and what singers you love to emulate or before you find your own voice. And a lot of those were American.
And who did you listen to growing up, Graeme? Who were the influences?
I think, just to carry on Marty's thread, the Isley Brothers, 3 Plus 3 was a big record back at the beginning, you know, when we first started. And you know,
I guess we
looked to America, you know. I
mean,
We went to Memphis really early on, you know, and so that was an amazing thing to do. We hadn't actually been at a Glasgow, and we didn't have passports or anything like that. So we went to Memphis and made a record with Willie Mitchell, who'd made records with Al Green and Carla Thomas and Ann Peebles and all. You know, that's what we were kind of listening to. When we first started, the record company said, who do you want to produce you? And we didn't even know what a producer was, you know, so we went back and looked at the records that
what
we loved.
What is a producer?
Well, I think it's someone, a kind of referee, you know, someone who takes your ideas and sort of is able to put it down in an articulate manner in a musical sense, you know
what
I mean?
Be inspired here in a catalyst. Some producers are kind of what the like vibe people who create a good atmosphere in the studio, and then there's other producers who bring in an entourage of session musicians. Whereas with us, we were four individuals and he managed to balance and get the best performances out of the four of us. Mm. You know, even though if we were young boys singing love songs and we might have never been in love, but we might have been all around the edges, you know, be able to, you know, as you say, some singers are good liars.
Yeah, and obviously, I mean, your greatest hit, I presume it's your greatest hit, Love Is All Around.
Oh, yeah.
Is a cover version.
Indeed it is.
Cover version, yes.
Does that take away from it at all for you?
No? Not at all, because we own that song, you know, and I think that it's a song that sits very well in our repertoire, and we made it very much like a Wet 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 song when we recorded it. And the first time we played it to Reg Presley, he said to you, I love what you've done with our song. And I think that's important because we put a piece of our heart into it as well as embellishing what he had done. It will always be his song.
Yeah, there for you guys for 16 weeks. At
16 weeks.
But it was beaten by what's-his-name? Robin Hood, wasn't
Brian
it?
And Robin Hood beat it. It was exactly. Friar Tuck was on the vocals at the time. You remember Friar Tuck?
In actual fact, it was only 15 weeks. Brian Adams, he was there for 16 weeks. We were there for 15 weeks, you know. But we just felt, we stopped counting it in weeks, we started counting it in months, you know.
Money, so I thought you were going to say there.
Did you?
Do you ever get fed up singing it? Do you ever get fed up singing it? Because admit, when we were listening to it for all those many weeks, in the end we're like, oh, not this again.
Well, there was an element in that for us, but I think enough time has elapsed where we can look at it and go, that's a great piece of work, it's a great pop song, and it's something that we enjoy, and when we play it live, you know, lots of people enjoy it, and we've all been playing it live with this greatest hits tour that we're embarking.
And I suppose, guys, you enjoy it now all second time around, the fact that not only greatest hits album, but you're on tour.
Absolutely.
As well.
We're touring, we've been all around the country. We've got all the dates
there. Nice link.
Nice link. You should really think about doing this as a career. I mean, I might be flagging it up here,
but... I was thinking about it.
You know?
Shouted, is he smelling nice? Every time I enter him, he smells nice.
You are smelling nice, actually. Yeah, that's a very good point that you made earlier.
That's right. Me and you wear a similar aftershave.
We very do. My wife bought it for me, so I smell like him.
You sometimes feel as if you might be living under the shadow of Marty there. At times, like, oh, go on, stick it. A wee bit.
Marty, Graeme, thank you both very much. Wet, wet, wet. The greatest hits is out, and it's step by step. Thank you very much,
Steve.
Here's the weather.